शारदा देवी अज्ञान तिमिरापहाम श्रृंगेरि तनये सदा। ಓಂ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರುಭ್ಯೋ ನಮಃ. ಪ್ರಾತಃಸ್ಮರಣೀಯರಾದಂಥ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಬಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್ ಮತ್ತು ಅವರ ಸುಪುತ್ರರಾದಂಥ ಶ್ರೀ ಬಿ ಸೂರ್ಯಪ್ರಕಾಶ್ ಅವರು ಅವರನ್ನು ಮನದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೃತ್ಪೂರ್ವಕವಾಗಿ ಗೌರವಪೂರ್ವಕವಾಗಿ ಸ್ಮರಿಸುತ್ತ ನಮಿಸುತ್ತ ಸ್ವಸ್ತಿ ಶ್ರೀ ವಿದ್ಯಾಭಿದಯ ಶ್ರೀ ನೃಪ ಶಾಲಿವಾಹನ ಶಕ 1943 ಗತಕಲಿ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಶಕ 5122 ಶಾರ್ವರಿ ನಾಮ ಸಂವತ್ಸರದ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಯನದ ಹೇಮಂತ ಋತುವಿನ ಮಾರ್ಗಶಿರ ಮಾಸದ ಶುಕ್ಲಪಕ್ಷದ ಪಂಚಮಿಯ ಶುಭ ಶನಿವಾರ ಮುಸ್ಸಂಜೆ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಆಯೋಜಿಸಿದಂಥ ಶ್ರೀ ಬಿ ಸೂರ್ಯಪ್ರಕಾಶ್ ಇವರ ಸ್ಮರಣಾರ್ಥ ದತ್ತಿ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಕ್ಕೆ ಜೋಡಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಆತ್ಮೀಯ ಆದರಣೀಯ ಸದಸ್ಯರಿಗೂ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಯ ಪ್ರೇಮಿಗಳಿಗೂ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ವಿಜಯಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಿ ಬಾಳೆಕುಂದ್ರಿ ಮಾಡುವ ಹೃತ್ಪೂರ್ವಕ ವಂದನೆಗಳು ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳು. ಪ್ರಾಬಬ್ಲಿ ದ ಪ್ರದೀಪ್ ಆರ್ ಭೀಷ್ಮ ಪಿತಾಮಹ ಆಫ್ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಯ ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಈಸ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಬಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್. ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಬೋರ್ನ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಬಟ್ ಹೌಎವರ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಅ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಟೀಚರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅ ಟ್ರೆಮೆಂಡಸ್ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ ಹಿ ಗಾಟ್ ಅಟ್ ಅ ಯಂಗ್ ಏಜ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಹಿಸ್ grandfather professor b suryanarayan rao and it was so wonderful that with the blessings of his grandfather he started the jyotishya vidyana and then he became a greatest icon or a legend of his time probably he became the astrologer of the century and not a single person can attain so much and do so much in one life as much as Dr. B. V. Raman did. He spent his whole life, entire life, in studying the relationship between the cosmic and the studying the relationship between the cosmic and the terrestrial phenomena. The astrological magazine was started by him, and then he continued for 62 years. Probably it's a world record for a single person to continue a magazine of that caliber, and we are so proud of him. And in 1936 he continued, and then probably he traveled all over the world, especially USA, Australia, France, Italy, started the Council of Astrological Science, which was registered in 1984, and he became a fountain of inspiration for hundreds of people to study astrology in India. ನ ಭೂತೋ ನ ಭವಿಷ್ಯೋ ಅನ್ನುವ ಹಾಗೆ ಅದ್ಭುತ ಅಪರೂಪದ ಅಪರಿಮಿತ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನ ಸಾಧಿಸಿದಂಥ ಬಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್ ಅವರು ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಯ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಕ್ಕೆ ಅಜರಾಮಜರಾಗಿ ಉಳಿದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಸನ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಬಿ ಸೂರ್ಯಪ್ರಕಾಶ್ ಹಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ವಾಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಅ ಭಾಸ್ಕರ ಇನ್ ದ ಸ್ಕೈ. ಹಿ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಶೈನಿಂಗ್ ಅಟ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಯಂಗ್ ಏಜ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೋರ್ಡೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದ ಅಸ್ಟ್ರಾಲಜಿಕಲ್ ಸೊಸೈಟಿ ಇನ್ ದ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ at a very young age, and he exhibited high intelligence and memory. Though he lived for a short time, he did enormous work. Unfortunately, left his mortal world in 1963. Since 1991, we started having the endowment program in his name, and for past 30 years continuously we have been having this great endowment lecture. And today we have none other than Dr. Archana Murthy to present. However, I'm very happy to introduce that Niranjan Babu's son, that is the brother of Surya Prakash, the son of B.V. Raman, his son, Sri Raman Suprarajaram, is continuing the great legacy of the illustrious grandfather and his uncle. And he has continued as a senior editor of Astrological Magazine. his political fortunes and future of the countries and elections, etc., are very, very popular all over the country and all over the world. He is a man behind a free Vedic astrology mobile application called as Suryalaya. And we have extremely fortunate to have today Ms. Archana, who is going to deliver the endowment lecture. And a very lovely, charming and enthusiastic Archana Murthy is a consultant in astrology and the Vastu. And she was trained by none other than her own father. We always say, Mane Modala Patashale Taye Modala Guru. But her guru was her father. And then she went into his shoes, and then she has become so popular. She got her training in Singapore, MBA, and she worked in corporate world for 18 years as a senior manager, working both in India and USA with a master's degree in Jyotisha and Vastu Shilpa from prestigious university. She has also obtained the Sanskrit COVID from Sanskrit Bharati. She is currently pursuing Acharya Setu in Jyotisha Shastra from Rashtriya Samskrita Samsthan, now known as a central Sanskrit university in the country. And here we have a person who has continued the legacy of her father in a great way. We are very fortunate to have her with us to deliver today's lecture. And we have also a equally renowned and a scholar, Dr. G.R. Gayatri, with a master's degree in Sanskrit and is a well-known awarded with the several titles, Jyotisha Ratna, Jyotisha Vishwasharada, and Jyotisha Vishwabhushana, and Divya Jyoti College Astrology. And she has secured advanced diploma in astrology. And we are fortunate to have, every time people ask for 33% for women, but today we have 100% for women. We have the endowment lecture delivered by Archana Murthy and presided over by Dr. Gayatri. And I'm sure it's going to be one of its kind to be remembered forever. I welcome Dr. Archana to go ahead and deliver her lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi ma'am, for your introduction. And thank you, Institute of World Culture. I would like to express my gratitude and to Niranjan Babu sir and Mr. Supraja Raman for providing me an opportunity to spread Jyotish Shastram knowledge. Niranjan Babu sir, I have had the fortunate, a good fortune in attending your lectures previously in conferences. And it is very impressive to see that your passion has not been limited by your age. Mr. Supraja Raman, you have learned the science at such a young age, this vast science. I have seen your YouTube videos. They're very knowledgeable and extremely interesting. And of course, we all know, like Mrs. Vijayalakshmi said, that Dr. B.V. Raman sir is well known all over the world. He is the father of modern astrology. And I have read many books growing up. I take inspiration from the way he spread Jyotish Shastra knowledge worldwide and took it to the next level. And I'm honored to be part of this endowment lecture series in the memory of Sri Surya Prakash sir, who was an extraordinary intelligent person, especially in astrology. And thank you, Dr. Gayatri ma'am, for presiding over this event. And finally, Mr. Girish and Mr. Vinay for supporting it. Before I start the event, I would like to thank my guru and father, Professor Dr. N.S. Murthy, who has guided me into the science and continues to mentor me into Jyotish Shastram. And I would also like to thank Mrs. Gayatri Srinivas ma'am for helping me with my initial journey. And of course, the last but not the least, thank you all viewers for attending this event, logging in at 6 p.m. on a Saturday evening. I'm sure you will find this session helpful and interesting. Let's begin. Our topic for the day is unraveling the science behind Vedic astrology. Vedic astrology, it's an English word. What do we call in Sanskritam? Jyotish Shastram. Jyotish and Shastram. Shastram means science. Science is already in the name. Platforms like these give us an opportunity to reiterate and remind people as to how Jyotish Shastram is indeed a science. My aim is to always start from the basics and especially with the most common terminology. Let's start with the word nakshatram. What is nakshatram? Do you really know what nakshatram means? Well, when I ask around to my acquaintances or friends or, you know, in my sessions, they say, yeah, we know what is nakshatram. But when I probe further, then they don't seem to be clear. And over time, I've realized that the concept is not clear to a lot of people. So let's go back in time. Our sages identified certain celestial objects which had an impact on us. So what was the next step? They decided to name these celestial objects. Now, they learned more about the celestial objects, learned about their characteristics, and grouped them separately. They grouped a set of 27 celestial objects and called these nakshatras. Nakshatram, when you break it down, it means na ksharati iti nakshatram. Arthat, yasya ksharanam hrasahava na bhavati. Which means objects that have little or no movement. Well, please remember, they did not have any modern gadgets like telescopes, but still, they identified these celestial objects and gave a perfect name called nakshatram. Please understand, in Sanskritam, even an insignificant object like a chair is named based on its characteristics, asandaha, and it's not named randomly. It is based on the characteristic. So, nakshatram, the name, was named as per the characteristics and there was nothing random about it. Who do we call the person who studies the astral world? We call them astroscientists. Isn't that also the apt name for our rishis who studied the astral world? In Sanskritam, we call them Jyotishagna or Daivagna, who are knowledgeable of the astral world. When we talk to our kids or grandkids about our India's glorious past and the great discoveries that we have done, then the current generation imagines a person with a saffron robe and they're not able to relate as to how these discoveries were made. So I feel it is our duty to represent our past accurately and so that the current generation is able to relate it. Also, in order to do that, you should know your roots properly and your basics properly. Only then you will be able to impart this knowledge to the current generation. So let's come back to the terminology nakshatram that I'm stressing upon. Fine, our ancestors identified the 27 nakshatras, nakshatrani, right? Now, they identified them. So coming back to our example, Mrugashira Nakshatram. It's a cluster of three stars with the shape of a deer's face. Now, the shape is a deer's face, like I said. Mruga means deer. Face is Shira, Mrugashira. The modern name is Lambda Orionis. Now, what is Nakshatram called in English? It is called asterism. The 27 nakshatras in the zodiac belt were identified by our sages. Now, a question for you all. Are all 27 nakshatras called asterisms? Yes, that is right. All the 27 nakshatras are called asterisms. Well, if I put the question the other way around, will it apply the same way? That is, are all asterisms called nakshatras? No. Why is that so? Because the 27 nakshatras that are on the zodiac belt and which were identified by our sages, they identified that these 27 nakshatras were the only ones that impacted our life. And hence, these are the only ones valid to be called nakshatras. And we continued our research and the application on our day-to-day life. So this is the zodiac belt that we are talking about. So, but modern science went beyond this, and they, of course, they identified a lot more asterisms. But we in Jyotish Shastram are not concerned, because we know that these are the important nakshatras that influence us. And hence, all nakshatras are asterisms, but all asterisms are not nakshatras. Let's look at an interesting concept. Jyeshta Nakshatram. We know Jyeshta Nakshatram is the 18th nakshatram from Ashwini. It has three stars. It is in the shape of a kundalam. The modern name is Antares. What does Jyeshta mean in Sanskritam? Elder, older, greater. All right, let's look at a modern discovery that we have seen. Antares, the red star, is at the end of its life. That's what you see here as the heading. What it means out here is Jyeshta or Antares is really old and is at the end of its life. This is the modern discovery that we have made. Now, all right, do you remember the meaning of Jyeshta that I had told earlier? Jyeshta meant older. That was one of the meanings. All right, let's look at another discovery about Jyeshta. As per this particular, I'm going to quote that. If Antares replaced the sun in our solar system, its circumference would extend beyond the fourth planet, beyond the orbit of the fourth planet, Mars. Okay, what it means is that if Antares could actually replace our sun in the solar system, then its circumference is so huge, bigger than the sun, that it'll extend up to Mars. So in this picture, what you see is this is Jyeshta or Antares. And where is the sun here? The small dot that you see here, that is our sun. So you can imagine how big Jyeshta is compared to our sun. Now, remember the other meaning that we knew saw earlier for Jyeshta? Bigger. Isn't it amazing that this particular 18th nakshatram from Ashwini out of the 27 nakshatras was called Jyeshta and not any other? Our Rishi scientists knew the characteristics of this nakshatram, knew the granularity level of these characteristics, and hence named them accordingly. All right, we named them, we identified 27 nakshatras, named them. What is the next step? Record it. Spread the knowledge. How did our gurus do that? Our gurus did it as part of the Gurukul system or the Guru Parampara. Nakshatras are referred in our Vedas. The 27 nakshatras that are there is mentioned in Rig Veda and Yajur Veda in these shlokas. Now, when you look at the shloka, the first question that comes to your mind is, all the 27 nakshatras, are they really embedded in the shloka? This seems to look like a small shloka, isn't it? Now, our rishis were so advanced that they actually put all the names of the nakshatras in the shloka in a coded language. Let's decipher the code. The code was that either the letter, for instance, Jau, was the name of the deity of the nakshatra, or contained the letter of the nakshatra. Let's look at a few examples. Jau in Ashwini, Yashwayujau, Jau represents Ashwayujau, that is Ashwini Kumaras, who are the deities of Ashwini Nakshatra. So Jau represents Ashwini Nakshatra. Dra is the letter in Ardra Nakshatra. Gaha represents the deity Bhagaha, which is one of the 12 Adityas, and is the deity of Purva Phalguni Nakshatra. So Gaha represents Purva Phalguni Nakshatra. Khe represents Vishakha Nakshatra. Shwe again is the name Vishwe, the deity of Uttara Shadha Nakshatra. He is the letter, is present in the deity's name Ahir Budnyaha, which is the deity for Uttara Bhadrapad Nakshatra, and so on. All the 27 nakshatras were named, or where the letters of those were taken and embedded in the shloka that we saw earlier. We know, or we have read in Vishnu and Matsya Puranas, that Chandra is the son of Atri Maharishi. And in Brahma Vaivarta Puranam, it is noted that Chandra married Daksha's 27 daughters. The 27 daughters represents 27 nakshatras. But Chandra was very infatuated, or was always spending more time with Rohini Nakshatram. Out of the 27 nakshatrams, he was spending, but he was only spending more time with Rohini Nakshatram. Now, do you know that this phenomenon of Chandra spending time with Rohini Nakshatram is called lunar occultation of Aldebaran? Aldebaran is another name for Rohini Nakshatram. It's a modern name given to Rohini Nakshatram. Let me give you a background of occultation. Now, occultation, in simple terms, means an eclipse. Lunar occultation means where the moon's path, when it covers an object, it is called lunar occultation. For instance, if it covers an asterism or a nakshatram, it is called lunar occultation. All right. Now, we come back to our topic. We were talking about the phenomenon that lunar occultation of Aldebaran or Rohini Nakshatram. There are many articles or many researches that now people are, you know, doing on this particular lunar occultation with Rohini. So these are the various articles that you can see, and there is continuous research being done on this. It is really impressive that our ancestors mentioned this phenomenon in such clear terms eons ago in Brahma Vaivarta Puranam. Now, it makes you think, how did our rishi scientists observe this phenomenon so closely, and they were so innovative in their techniques, and they wrote it in a story form so that all of us remember even now, centuries later. Let's go to the next topic, Tithi. What is Tithi? Again, a common word. Tithi, Sri Ramanavami, Vijayadashami, Durgashtami, Nagapanchami are all these popular festivals. For people who have not heard the word Tithi, Navami in Ramanavami represents Tithi, Ashtami in Durgashtami represents Tithi, and so on. Tithi in actual terms means date. In English calendar, how is a day represented? Date represented? It is represented as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and goes on till 31. Now, that is the every day of the month. In our Hindu lunisolar calendar, The tithis are represented in numbers in the numbering system in Sanskritam. So 1 is Pratipada, 2 is Dvitiya, 3 is Tritiya, and so on. And this numbering system is also adopted in our regional languages. Now, please remember, the date in English calendar 1 does not coincide with Pratipada in our Hindu calendar. For instance, today it is Panchami 5 as per Panchami Tithi, whereas the date is 19th. It does not coincide. Now, we have 30 days, average of 30 days in a month in an English calendar. But then how come there are only 15 tithis? Now, in the Hindu calendar, tithis are not just numbers. Tithi by definition is Surya Chandrayoho Gatyantaram Tithihi Bhavati. The difference in the motion between sun and moon is called tithi. We'll explain that clearly now. Do you see the moon revolving around the earth? It goes 360 degrees around the earth. Now, here we start at the starting point where we see that this is the earth, moon, and the sun. The moon is between the earth and the sun, and it's in a straight line. Now, this when the degree is zero, that is, it is in the straight line, that is when Amavasya ends. That is, the new moon ends. This is the starting point for our Tithi discussion. When moon moves 12 degrees in this angle, then the Pratipada, 0 to 12 degrees, is called Pratipada. And when it moves further, 24 degrees, it is called Dvitiya, that is, it's the second Tithi. The third Tithi is called Tritiya, which ends at 36 degrees. Chaturthi ends at 48 degrees. Panchami at 60 degrees. Shashti, sixth Tithi, ends at 72 degrees. And you see how the moon is actually moving around, and that's how we named our Tithis. Saptami is 84 degrees. And you also can see that the moon is growing in size. So this is the waxing phase of the moon. Ashtami, 8th Tithi, Navami, Dashami, Ekadashi, 11th Tithi, ends at 132 degrees, Dvadashi, Trayodashi, Chaturdashi, and finally the 15th Tithi, Purnima, when the moon covers 180 degrees, half the movement. And now it is the full moon. We see the moon completely. Again, moon, earth, and sun are in a straight line, but moon is not between the earth and the sun. It's the other way around, 180 degrees away, and hence we see the moon. Now, this whole process of Amavasya to Purnima is called Shukla Paksha. Shukla means white, and hence the waxing represents the waxing phase of the moon from no moon to full moon, where the moon is growing in size as seen from earth. Now, from Purnima to Amavasya is the mirror image of how the moon travels from here. From Purnima, when it travels 12 degrees, it is called Pratipada. Again, the first Tithi, but it's in the other phase. Dvitiya ends at 204 degrees. Tritiya, Chaturthi, fourth Tithi. And you can see the moon is, you know, reducing in size. Panchami, Shashti, Saptami, Ashtami, 8th Tithi, Navami, it's almost becoming a crescent moon now, Ekadashi, Dvadashi, Trayodashi, Chaturdashi, we almost can't see, and then finally Amavasya, when it comes back to 360 degrees or comes back to the starting point when it ends. Now, this whole journey that the moon takes from Purnima to Amavasya is called Krishna Paksha. Krishna means dark and represents the waning phase of the moon. And hence, this is called the Krishna Paksha. Now, this is a mirror image of the Shukla Paksha. That's what we saw. So this was the waxing and the waning phase. And hence, it's exactly a mirror image. So when we go back to the English calendar system, we notice now that there is no correlation with nature. The numbers are just numbers to represent a calendar system. And in fact, if you see, the months have just, you know, random days. February has 28 days, July has 31, August 31. Do you know why July and August have 31 days back to back? Why? Because Julius Caesar wanted a month named after him. And he wanted, you know, the number of days to be more. So he said, my month should have 31 days. Now, when Augustus Caesar came into power, he said, I don't want to be less popular. So even the month should be named after me. And it should also consider 31 days. Now, these are the reasons behind the naming of the, you know, either the days or the naming of the months in the English calendar system. Whereas our Hindu calendar system is not like that. It is in complete correlation with nature based on the moon's revolution. And that is why our scientists or rishis identified that 15 tithis were actually replicating each other as a mirror image, and we required only 15 tithis. Instead, we recognized the phase, the waxing phase and the waning phase, and called it Krishna and Shukla Paksha. So, don't you think our calendar should be called scientific calendars, because it is based on astronomical events and not just dates? In fact, it can also be called astronomical calendars. I think it is a matter of pride that we have such a scientific system to derive or identify the date, tithi, month, rutu, vara, and samvatsara. It's really sad that we don't get to study this scientific system in our school and college days. And when I started off my journey into Jyotish Shastram, I was looking for a pictorial representation of these fundamental concepts, but I was not able to find. And hence, it's my humble attempt to actually put out this kind of pictorial representation for our future generations so that they are able to understand and appreciate our scientists' efforts in identifying and naming these dates. And I have posted these kind of videos in my YouTube channel. And to know more about these kind of, you know, phenomenons or these more about astrology, it is great if you subscribe to magazines such as Astrologically magazine, where you will be able to understand more about astrology. Okay, this is the beauty of Jyotish Shastram. If you actually look at it, the Jyotish Shastram knowledge was not limited to only gurus or royals, you know, like the king or the queen or the rishis, but this knowledge was common to even a layman like you and me. And why was it so? Because our rishis were so smart. They embedded all these scientific concepts in our rituals. So there was no way we could forget it. And that is why it is still alive and present even after centuries in this world. The next topic is grahas. What is a graha? It can be related to the verb grihnati, seize or capture. So the object that seizes and hence has an influencing effect is called graha. Now, when I say graha, what is the equivalent English word that comes to your mind? You might say planet. Well, graha is not planet. Let's look at the etymology of planet. It came from a Greek word. It means wanderer. Well, the Greeks, what they did was, they looked at the celestial objects and they identified that there were a few celestial objects that moved differently from stars. And hence, they named these as planets. Astronomically, planet is called astronomical body that moves around the sun. All right, we have realized that etymologically, graha is different, which seizes and captures and has an influencing effect. And planet just meant an object around the sun. Okay, who got it wrong? Did we get it wrong? That graha, that, you know, these are the grahas? Well, We got it right. Astronomically speaking, our sages knew very clearly that the sun was in the middle and the objects were revolving around it. All right, this theory is called heliocentric theory. Helio is the sun and sun is in the middle. Now, this concept is documented in our ancient texts. So we know that our rishis were aware of it, but they went one step further. They just didn't stop and knowing the concept, okay, sun is there and you know all the objects were revolving around it. They went one step further. They identified which of all the celestial objects had an influence on us, because we are in, you know, we really want to know what influences us, isn't it? Because what affects us is what is important to us. So they went one step further and identified it. And hence, you would see even sun and moon as a graha in our Jyotish Shastram, because we know that all these 9 grahas have an important influence on us. So let's look at the rays emitted by grahas. Surya, let's start with Surya. Surya is our soul, life giver, energy provider. No living being can exist without Surya. In Jyotish Shastram, Surya is called the Arogya Karaka. In Jyotish Shastram, it was already mentioned that Surya was Arogya Karaka, but eventually it is now proved. In Matsya Puranam, there is a shlokam which says, Arogyam Bhaskarat Ichet, Dhanam Ichet, Dudhashanat, Ishwaraj, Jnanaman Vichet, Moksham Ichet, Janardanat. What it means is, health ought to be sought from the sun, wealth from Agni, knowledge from Ishvara, and moksha from Janardana. It is also the same concept is there even in Jyotish Shastram, that Surya is Arogya Karaka. Surya has another name called Arkaha. Now, Arka is also a plant. In Telugu, we call it Jilledu. And in Ayurveda, it is noted that Arka cures 52 diseases. You would have heard about Arka during the Ratha Saptami ritual. What is Ratha Saptami? Ratha Saptami is a Surya Jayanti, or when Surya gains momentum in Uttarayana, and it basically tells us that summer is approaching. Hence, we have a ritual where we use the Arka leaves in the bathing ritual, so that it cools and heals us and we are prepared for the intense heat that follows further. And hence, now the next example that I can take about Surya is photosynthesis. Now, what is photosynthesis? Plant gains energy from the sun rays. And when we consume the plants, this particular food is converted into prana and we get life in our body. And it also affects our mental health. So Ayurveda, our indigenous medical science, has always stressed upon the food that we eat impacts our medical health, mental health, and physical health. In Jyotish Shastram, Surya's malefic effects are known to be reduced by the gem ruby. Why is that so? Ruby emits micro form of sun rays. That's what it's seen. And that's what it's, noted. What happens is when it emits the micro form of sun rays, it balances the negative effect or the lack of sufficient sun rays that are being absorbed by us. All right. Another malefic effect of Surya. Now, when I say malefic effect, that means that Surya is in one of the bad houses or the dusthanas, like 6th or 8th or 12th bhava. And one of the malefic effects is that it affects the spinal cord. What is the popular and a simple remedy that comes to your mind when I say a spinal cord remedy or spinal cord issue remedy? Surya Namaskara. Again, and it has been proven all over the world that Surya Namaskara can be used to cure spinal cord issues. So do you see the pattern here? The graha that is not in a favorable position is the cure as well. Let's go to the next graha, Chandra. The other name for Chandra is Manokaraka. Karaka means operates on it. So Manokaraka operates on the mind. Now, this concept is so ancient, and earlier people did not believe that Chandra affected the people with weak mental health. But now we all know that mental health institutions are on high alert when it comes to, you know, during the full moon and the no moon days. Another name in Hindi for Chandra is Chandmara. Who is referred, you know, a Chandmara is a person or a word which is referred to a person with weak mental health or mental health issues. Chandmara means, as you know clearly by the name, affected by the moon. This is in our vocabulary. Imagine that. And another concept of Chandra. Chandra is also known for Jala Tattva. Now we all know that it affects the tides. The high tide, low tide, all is controlled by the moon. Now, when it controls the tides, don't you think it actually affects 2/3 of our body, which is covered with the watery substance of blood and plasma? Of course. There is a research that was seen that by Canadian scientists that 75% heart disease deaths occurred on Monday mornings. Okay, there is another research by Scottish team where they have corroborated that deaths from heart disease peak on Mondays. Okay, why Monday? Remember, Monday is called Somavara. Soma means moon. Why did we name Monday Somavara? Monday is named Somavara because the first hora on Monday is operated by the moon. Similarly, on Tuesday, the first hora is operated by Mars, and hence it is called Mangalavara, Budhavara, etc., and so on. That is the Vara names. Now, Monday, coming back to the point, Monday, the first hora is affected by the moon. So if you see the connection between Somavara and the heart disease issues or a heart risk issues, we know in Jyotish Shastram that Chandra effect has a huge effect on blood pressure, and it also governs Mondays. And hence you can see the correlation that the effect on blood pressure is higher on Mondays because of the moon's effect. Next planet, Mangala, Mars. What is the other name for Mangala? Bhumiputra. Well, why is this particular planet called Bhumiputra? Bhumiputra means the son of Bhumi. Bhumi means earth. Okay. Now, as late as in the 19th century, the scientists have realized that Mars is very similar in characteristics with Earth. And mankind is spending millions of dollars researching on the possibility of life on Mars. Well, we can't stop appreciating our rishis for the granularity of the knowledge on how they knew that the Mars or Mangala was similar in characteristics with Earth, and how they accurately named only this particular graha as Bhumiputra. I really can't stop appreciating. All right, now we saw that ruby reduces the malefic effects of Surya. Similarly, coral also reduces the malefic effects of Mangala. That's what we have seen. Again, due to the positive rays of coral. So one of the malefic effects of Mangala is accident, which leads to a fracture. Bone fracture cures. Let's look at it. Earlier, in order to cure a bone fracture, they used to use the bones from the dead bodies. But that used to provide in that used to, you know, end up with infections, and hence they discontinued this practice. Then the next practice was that they inserted a rod in the place of the fracture. And when the bone used to grow out, they used to remove the rod. But there was an interesting discovery made that coral cures bone fractures. There was a research in France called bone setting research where they saw that coral could cure bone fracture. So a few articles for your notice. Coral has been used for bone graft since 1970 because coral has the advantages of good osteoconduction, biocompatibility, and biodegradation. All right, that is one article. Why? Let's see that. Now, this is a fracture that you can see. And in this fracture, when they actually inserted coral, what happened over time was it converted or changed into bone. Why? Because coral has a similar structure of a bone. And from since 1982, several thousand patients have been cured by the cure of coral in the bone fracture. Another article, which again says that previous studies showed that natural coral implanted into bone tissue was gradually resorbed and progressively replaced by newly formed bone. Irish Times says the same thing. Coral is an ideal bone graft substitute. Popular Science. Scientists learned to repair human bones by studying coral reefs. Kolkata scientists that converted coral discs, they actually said that the coral discs are more effective in bone tissue regeneration when infused with growth factors. So the malefic effects of Mangala can be cured by coral. This was documented in Jyotish Shastram eons ago. Now, another concept of Mangala. Mangala governs red color. And Mangala is also said to govern blood or affects blood as per Jyotish Shastram. It is seen that if an anemic person is placed in a red colored room, then the red blood corpuscles increase over time. So let's take another example, another graha, Guru, Jupiter. Again, similar. Malefic placement of Guru in a horoscope. One of the effects is diabetes. Now, we also know in Jyotish Shastram that Guru is the Lord for Methi and Turmeric. Methi is fenugreek. Methi and Turmeric. These Methi and Turmeric is said to have been grown with the positive rays of Guru Graha. Now, what we have seen is that people who have consumed milk with turmeric over time have not attracted diabetes. That is the research we are reading right now. So a few articles for you. The curcumin, the active component in turmeric, may help prevent type 2 diabetes. Research has also suggested that taking turmeric could treat and prevent diabetes. Another article which says that you not only prevent it, it also can reverse diabetes. You know, many studies have suggested that turmeric might also protect against the development. And here it says that it also slows down diabetes or reverse it. Now, we know that even Methi cures diabetes. We saw earlier that Guru is the Lord for Methi. Even Methi cures diabetes. Some of the articles supporting the statement. Fenugreek in diabetes. Many of these studies focus on the seed's ability to lower blood sugar in people with diabetes. Another example, Buddha, Mercury. Now, if Buddha is placed in a, you know, malefic placement in the horoscope, we know that it causes skin issues. Buddha is also noted in Jyotish Shastram that it is the Lord for Neem. We know Neem actually cures skin issues. Now, I can't stop with the examples. There are many examples that have been proved by modern science now. And in medical astrology, that is what we have learned or what we have seen till now, that effects of graha when it is not favorable. What does it mean when it is not favorable? That means that the graha, if it's not favorable in the horoscope, means that is an improper distribution of light. So what are the remedies for it? Mani, mantra, aushadha, pertaining to that planet itself or that particular graha itself. That is when you can actually cure it. So I would like to conclude by saying that Jyotish Shastram is indeed an incredible science. It is so ancient, but still relevant even today. And my advice to aspiring astrologers would be, please read astrology in the original language, our mother tongue or our mother of all languages, Sanskritam, so that you can avoid incorrect translations. And in the process, because as a student of Sanskritam, I would recommend to start off from Sanskrita Bharati, where you can learn this language. And visit my YouTube channel if you want to learn the fundamentals like these videos, and you know, and get your fundamentals right, where I have mentioned during, you know, with a lot of my videos. Dhanyavadaha. So I would like to open the forum for questions.
Excellent. It was a very lucid and a very clear picture that you gave. And in fact, being a cardiologist, I can't agree more with you when you said that sun is Arogyakara. Today, we have come to know that vitamin D is in the center of the storm. And all diseases, including heart attack, are because of the deficiency of vitamin D. And vitamin D is synthesized by in the presence of sunlight, the ultraviolet. True. So I think you can add that. And that is an amazing one, you know. And regarding the Jala Tattva, you said, you know, the whole body consists of water, and without water, water is a Jiva Jala. It is called elixir of life in the Rigveda. So I think the Jala Tattva also has got an amazing thing. And being a wife of orthopedic surgeon who was using the coral thing for bone grafting, and I know very well, it is an amazing one. It is amazing. In fact, you can call it as an excellent treatment for the bone. And I can't agree less. So I'm sure the audience will have many questions, and you are the right person to answer them. Any questions?
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, if there are no questions, it means only two things. Either they have understood everything that you told so clearly, or they have not understood. So I would like to take the first one and request Dr. Gayatri to deliver her presidential address and sum up the things. Thank you.
Good evening. Lago Namaskara. ಬಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್ ಅವರ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಅವರು ಸೂರ್ಯನಾರಾಯಣ ಅವರ ಬಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್ ಅವರ ತಂದೆಯವರಾದ ಸೂರ್ಯನಾರಾಯಣ ಅವರ ಹಾಕಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿರುವಂತಹ ಮೇಲ್ಪಂಕ್ತಿಯಲ್ಲೇ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರವನ್ನು ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುಗಳು ಕಲಿಸಿರಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈಗ ನಾನು ರಾಮಾನುಜ ಗುರುಕುಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ಈ ಒಂದು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸಮ್ಮೇಳನದಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನನ್ನು ಭಾಗವಹಿಸೋದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಆರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ತುಂಬ ಕೃತಜ್ಞಳಾಗಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ನಾನು ಹೇಳುವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಏನು ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಗೆ ಉಳಿದೇ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಕರೇ ಆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಅದನ್ನ ತಲುಪಿಸೋದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ NS ಮೂರ್ತಿಯವರ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಗುರು ಸಮಾನರೇ. ನೇರವಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುಗಳು ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ಇರ್ಬೋದು NS ಮೂರ್ತಿಯವರು, ಆದ್ರೆ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ವಿಧ ಸಮ್ಮೇಳನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತು ಅವರು ಬರೆದಿರುವಂತಹ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಲೇಖನಗಳನ್ನು ನಾನು ಓದಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ಅದರಿಂದ ಅವರಲ್ಲೂ ನನಗೆ ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಪೂಜ್ಯ ಭಾವನೆ ಇದೆ. ಅವರ ಮಗಳಾಗಿ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಅವರು ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಇದನ್ನ ಜನಕ್ಕೆ ಅರ್ಥವಾಗುವ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬಾ ಸಾಧಾರಣ ಸರಳವಾದ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಅಸ್ಟ್ರಾಲಜಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಹೇಗೆ ನಾವು ಆಂಗ್ಲ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಇದನ್ನ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಇದನ್ನು ಒಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಕಂಪ್ಯಾರಿಟಿವ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ಮಾಡೋ ತರ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಅವಕಾಶವನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರುವಂತಹ ಶ್ರೀ ಪಿ ವಿ ರಾಮನ್ನವರ ಮಕ್ಕಳಾದ ಶ್ರೀ ನಿರಂಜನ್ ಬಾಬು ಗುರುಗಳಿಗೋ ಮತ್ತು ಅವರ ಮಕ್ಕಳಾದ ಸುಪ್ರಜಾರಾಮನ್ನು ಈಗ ವಿಶ್ವಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಒಂದು ಅಂತಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಕರಾಗಿ ನಮಗೆ ಅಲಂಕರಣ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶ ಹಾಗೂ ನಮ್ಮ ರಾಜ್ಯ ಹಾಗೂ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ನಮ್ಮನ್ನ ಎತ್ತಿ ಹಿಡಿಯುವಂತಹ ಒಂದು ಮಠದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವರ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮೇಲ್ಪಂಕ್ತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಗಳಿಗೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ಪಾಠಗಳು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದರಂತೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ನನಗೂ ಒಂದು ಅವಕಾಶ ಕಲ್ಪಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ತುಂಬಾ ಚಿರಋಣಿಯಾಗಿದ್ದೇನೆ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ. ಈ ಮೂಲಕ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳನ್ನ ಸಮರ್ಪಣೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಾಗ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕಮ್ಮಿ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಲೆಕ್ಕಾಚಾರದ ಇದು ಒಂದು ಇದೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಅವರು ತಿಥಿ ಇದನ್ನ ಹೇಗೆ ಲೆಕ್ಕ ಮಾಡೋದು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದರಂತೆ ಇವರು ಬೃಹತ್ ಹೋರಾಫಲ ಚಿಂತಾಮಣಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಯಥಾಶಿಖ ಮಯೂರಾಣ ನಾಗಾನ ಮಣಯೋ ಯಥ ತದ್ವದ್ ವೇದಾಂಗ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರಾಣ ಗಣಿತ ಮೂರ್ಧನಿ ಸ್ಥಿತಂ ಅಂತ. ಹಾಗೆ ಈ ಯಾವುದೇ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಆದ್ರೂ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾದ ಗಣಿತ ಸಾಕು ಇದಕ್ಕೇನೋ, ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಇದೇನು ಬೇಕಾಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದರಂತೆ ಇವರು ತುಂಬಾ ಸುಲಭವಾಗಿ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಅವರು ಅವರ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ಗಳ ಮೂಲಕ ಜನಸಾಮಾನ್ಯರು ಯಾವುದೇ ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಮಗು ಈಗ ನಮ್ಗಳಿಗಿಂತ ಸಣ್ಣ ಮಕ್ಕಳೇ ಈ ಒಂದು ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಅನ್ನು ನೋಡುವಂತ ಇದನ್ನ ಈ ಅಂತರ್ಜಾಲ ವಿದ್ಯೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಕರಗತವಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಅದರಿಂದ ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಅವರು ಪಾರಂಗತ್ಯವನ್ನು ಪಡಿತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ ಇದನ್ನ ಆಗೋ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ಇವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇದೇ ರೀತಿ ಇವರು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸ್ಲಿ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ನನ್ನ ಶುಭ ಹಾರೈಸ್ತೀನಿ. ಇವರನ್ನ ಇಷ್ಟು ಮಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡಿರುವಂತಹ ಅವರ ತಂದೆಯವರಾದ ಎನ್ ಎಸ್ ಮೂರ್ತಿ ಅವರ ಚರಣದಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನ ಅನಂತ ವಂದನೆಗಳು. ಹೀಗೆ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದದ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಾಗ ನಾವು ಆಯುರ್ವೇದ ವೈದ್ಯನ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡುವ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಒಂದಿದೆ. ಆ ಇದರಿಂದ ಹೇಳಕ್ ಹೋದ್ರೆ ವೇದಗಳು ಅಂತ ನಾವೀಗ ನಾಲ್ಕು ವೇದಗಳು ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಉಪವೇದಗಳು ಇದೆ. ಋಗ್ವೇದಕ್ಕೆ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಉಪವೇದ, ಹಾಗೆ ಯಜುರ್ವೇದಕ್ಕೆ ಧನುರ್ವೇದ ಅಂತಾರೆ, ಸಾಮವೇದಕ್ಕೆ ಗಾಂಧರ್ವ ವೇದ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಅಥರ್ವ ವೇದಕ್ಕೆ ಅರ್ಥವೇದ ಅಥವಾ ಅರ್ಥಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಈಗ ಕರಿತೀವಿ, ಅಥವಾ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅಥರ್ವ ವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದದ ಭಾಗಗಳು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ ಇವುಗಳನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಉಪವೇದಗಳು ಅಂತ ಕರೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಅವರ ಒಂದು ಈ ಮಾಧ್ಯಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲವನ್ನು ಜನರಿಗೆ ತಿಳಿಪಡಿಸಕ್ ಹೊರಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ತುಂಬಾ ಸಂತೋಷವಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಇದೇ ರೀತಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚೆಚ್ಚು ಅವರು ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತದ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಒಂದು ಪರಿಣಿತಿಯನ್ನು ಅವರು ಪಡಿತಾರೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಧೈರ್ಯ ನಮ್ಗೆ ವಿಶ್ವಾಸ ಇದೆ. ಹೀಗಾಗಿ ಯಾಕೆಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಮಂತ್ರಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಯುಷ್ ಅನ್ನೋರು ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಸುವರ್ಣ ಪ್ರಾಶನ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ಈ ವೇದಾಂಗ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವೇದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಿದಂತಹ ಈ ಗ್ರಂಥಗಳ ಮೂಲಕನೇ ಅದನ್ನ ಆಧಾರವಾಗಿ ತಗೊಂಡು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಉದಾಹರಣೆ ಹೇಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಈ ಪುಷ್ಯ ನಕ್ಷತ್ರ ಡ್ರಾಪ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾರಲ್ವಾ ಸ್ವರ್ಣ ಪ್ರಾಶನ ಅಂತ, ಅದನ್ನ ಕಶ್ಯಪ ಸಂಹಿತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದಿದೆ. ಆ ಕಶ್ಯಪ ಸಂಹಿತೆ ಅನ್ನೋ ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಸೂತ್ರ ಸ್ಥಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ಬರುವಂತಹ ಎರಡು ಮೂರು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳ ಇದು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ನೀವು ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ರೆಫರ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸಿಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಅವರು, ಸುವರ್ಣ ಪ್ರಾಶನಮಿ ಏತತ್ ಮೇಧಾಗ್ನಿ ಬಲವರ್ಧನಂ ಆಯುಷ್ಯಂ ಮಂಗಲಂ ಪುಣ್ಯಂ ವೃಷ್ಯಂ ಗ್ರಹಾಪಹಂ ಅಂತ. ಮಾಸಾತ್ ಪರಮ ಮೇಧಾವಿ ಭಾವ್ಯಾದಿಭಿ ವ್ಯಾಧಿಭಿ ನ ದೃಶ್ಯತೆ ಷಡ್ಭಿ ಮಾಸೈ ಶ್ರುತಧರ ಸುವರ್ಣ ಪ್ರಾಶನಾತ್ ಭವೇತ್ ಅಂತ. ಹೀಗೆ ಸುವರ್ಣ ಪ್ರಾಶನ ಯಾಕೆ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಬೇಕು, ಅದರಿಂದ ಆಗೋ ಉಪಯೋಗಗಳನ್ನ ಕೇವಲ ಎರಡು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸೂತ್ರ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮ ಈ ಒಂದು ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಇಲಾಖೆಯವರು ವಿಸ್ತೃತವಾಗಿ ಅದನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇದೇ ರೀತಿ ವಯಸ್ಕರಿಗೂ ಕೊಡುವಂತ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ವಿಷಯಗಳು ಈ ಗ್ರಂಥಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಮುಂದೆ ಇರುವಂತಹ ನಮ್ಮ ಮುಂದಿನ ಪೀಳಿಗೆಯವರು ಅಥವಾ ಯುವ ಇವರುಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಸೇರ್ಕೊಂಡು ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ದೇಶದ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಸಂಪತ್ತನ್ನ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನಾನು ನಿರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಪಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಎಲ್ರೂ ಈ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದು. ಈ ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹಾಗೆ ಈ ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಆರೋಗ್ಯದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಆಯ್ತು, ಹಾಗೆ ಯಜುರ್ವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ಧನುರ್ವೇದ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ಎಜುಕೇಶನ್ ಅಂತಾನೆ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಯಾವುದೇ ವಿದ್ಯೆಯನ್ನು ತಗೊಂಡ್ರು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಯಜುರ್ವೇದ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು, ವಿದ್ಯಾಭ್ಯಾಸ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ಆ ಥರ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಮತ್ತೆ ಸಾಮವೇದದಲ್ಲಾದ್ರೆ ಲಲಿತ ಕಲೆಗಳು, ಎಲ್ಲಾ ತರದ ಕಲೆಗಳು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಅಥರ್ವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ಅರ್ಥಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವೃತ್ತಿಪರ ಅಥವಾ ನಿಧಿ ಸಂಗ್ರಹ ಫೈನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಈ ತರ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಬರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ನಾಳೆ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ನಾನು ಈ ಮೂಲಕ ಹೇಳೋ ಒಂದು ಸಂದೇಶ ಏನಂದ್ರೆ, ಈ ಒಂದು ಬೇರೆ ಉಪವೇದಗಳನ್ನು ನೀವು ಲಿಂಕ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ನಿಮ್ಮ ಮುಂದಿನ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಭಾವಗಳು ಮುಂದೆ ಬರುತ್ತಲ್ಲ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆನ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ವರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಹಿಂದೂ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸೋಕೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಭಾರತದ ಒಂದು ಮಹಿಮೆಯನ್ನು ವಿಶ್ವದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾರಬೇಕಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಾರ್ಥನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಇದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಬೆನ್ನೆಲುಬಾಗಿ ಅವ್ರ ತಂದೆಯವರೇ ನಿಂತಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇದು ನಿಜವಾಗ್ಲೂ ಹೆಮ್ಮೆ ಪಡುವಂತ ವಿಷಯ. ಹೀಗೆ ಇನ್ನು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಅವ್ರ ಮುಂದೆ ಬರಲಿ. ಇದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇಕಾದಷ್ಟು ತರದ ಒಂದು ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳು ಸಿಗುತ್ತೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾಡ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಅವ್ರ ಹತ್ರ ಪ್ರಾರ್ಥನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ಹೀಗೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ವಿಷಯವಾಗಿ ನನ್ನನ್ನು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕರೆದು ಈ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನನಗೆ ಈ ಇದನ್ನ ಪರಿಚಯ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಪೂಜ್ಯ ಗುರುಗಳಾದ ನಿರಂಜನ್ ಬಾಬು ಅವರು ಅವರ ಸಮೂಹಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಚಿರಋಣಿಯಾಗಿ ನನ್ನ ಈ ಒಂದೆರಡು ಮಾತುಗಳನ್ನು ಮುಗಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ಹೀಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಿರುವಂತಹ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಹಿರಿಯ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಕರುಗಳಿಗೂ, ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರು ಸಮಾನರಾದ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಜ್ಯೋತಿಷ್ಕರುಗಳಿಗೂ, ಮಿತ್ರ ಬಾಂಧವರಿಗೂ ನನ್ನ ಅನಂತ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳನ್ನ ಸಮರ್ಪಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಗಾಯತ್ರಿ ಅವರೇ. ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಒನ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ಟು ಅರ್ಚನಾ. ಯು ನೋ ಅವರ್ ರಿಷೀಸ್ ವರ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ದೇ ವರ್ ದ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್, ರಿಯಲಿ ದೇ ವರ್ ದ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್, ಅಂಡ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ದೇ ಡಿಡ್ ವಾಸ್ ಟೋಟಲಿ ಸೈಂಟಿಫಿಕ್, ಬಟ್ ಸಮ್ವೇರ್ ಓವರ್ ದ ಥೌಸಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಡಿಜನರೇಟೆಡ್, ಅಂಡ್ ನೌ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದ ಥಿಂಕಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಅಸ್ಟ್ರಾಲಜಿ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೇಕ್ and people are duping them. So sure. How do you look at this problem and how can we overcome that?
All right, I think I personally you know, I think what you need to do is, as a person who is interested or who does not really know if really astrology is a science or not, they should actually learn the science. Only then they will be able to understand if it's actually a science or not. Now, I have complete confidence that every particular aspect has a scientific basis. In fact, if you see, like I said, even the names were based on the scientific aspect. When the names itself can base on the scientific aspect, then how come, you know, where the rest of the subject or the rest of the material that is there in Jyotish Shastram will not be scientific? So modern science can be lagging behind, but that does not mean we, you know, don't really believe in Jyotish Shastram. So please learn the science and then make a judgment for yourself.
Okay, that's a very apt answer. And I have one more suggestion for that. We sure. need more and more people like Mr. Murthy, like your father, or B.V. Raman, who has inspired hundreds and thousands of people. Sure. I think your tribe must increase. Then only, you know, we'll have the scientific temperament among the youngsters, and that can go a long way. And in fact, I want to tell you a very interesting thing. When I went to Puerto Rico, San Juan, for a conference of pediatric cardiology, it was World Congress. And then, you know, they have a beautiful beach. And I was so tempted. So I wore my daughter's mirror work salwar kameez and happily started walking barefoot with the shoes in my hand. And okay. I saw two men coming from opposite side, and they were jogging. And the moment they looked at me, they stopped. I got worried. My God, they're such hefty Spanish fellows, you know. Why are they standing? Then they said, "You Indian?" I said, "Yes." "You English?" I said, "Yes." They know only Spanish and they right. don't know English, but they wanted to know whether I know English. And right. then, you know, both of them, they put their hands like this in front of me. And when they put the hand like this, I thought they are not looking like beggars. They are not testing. What's the matter? Why are they putting their palm like that? And okay. then, read hand. You know, they think that every Indian is an astrologer. Every Indian is a fortune teller. So the moment they say I'm Indian and I know English, they knew that I didn't know Spanish. So then they said, read hand. And then I just looked very seriously at both the hands. And then I said, you work hard, you'll become rich. And they were only rich. And they said, oh, rich, thank you. They went on going and going. You know? So this is how all over the world, India had. But now, I think thanks to the Bhishma Pitamaha, or you can call a modern Parashara Muni, B.V. Raman, he changed the whole scenario. And right. Thanks to Niranjan Babu and also his son, Ramasuprarajan. And I think they are doing amazing work. And the time has come to show to the whole world that we are more scientific than the Western world. And then the science is the basis of every Veda, whether it is Yajurveda, Samveda, including Ayurveda, which is the fifth Veda. I think it is time has come where the youngsters like you have to take it further. And what is Ramala Shastra?
Ramala Shastra is another Shastra, which is when you don't have a horoscope, or when you don't have your natal horoscope or the date and time of birth. A lot of people do not have date, time and place of birth. When they don't have that, then, and when they want answers to questions, if they're going into a particular, they want to decide on a particular, either go abroad or do some important event in their life, they actually go to Ramala Shastra. And I know the overview of Ramala Shastra. It is similar to, Prashna Jyotisha and these kind of areas. And I think Kerala is very popular with Ramala Shastra as well. And but that's also a very interesting concept. And of course, every branch of Jyotish Shastra, when you actually go into detail, it is a whole subject of its own. So, we have so many areas in Jyotish Shastram. And I just would like to remind everyone to say that Jyotish Shastram is not only pertained to fortune telling or prediction or only that, it is also for medical astrology. It also comprises of how you actually take a look at the country or how you are able to, take decisions in your life. But it starts from the scientific events, how they've identified. That is a Siddhanta Jyotisha part, and then it moves on to Phalita Jyotisha. So people know only Jyotish Shastram as Phalita Jyotisham, but I want people to always remember Jyotish Shastram means astronomy and predictive science. Whereas the modern, the astrology word, it's a very loosely captured word it is. Jyotish Shastram is a very powerful word. But astrology is just logic of the astros, which is the logic of the stars. That's not just logic. Jyotish Shastram is actually scientifically based, and astrology is more predictive based. So the word in English, astrology, is just half, when it comes to Jyotish Shastram. Jyotish Shastram is astronomy and predictive astrology.
Yeah, I think that's really wonderful. No, it is like our Indian Sanskriti and Western culture. Culture. Correct. Yeah, that's the subtle difference between the two. I think the same thing you are telling. Why I asked about Ramala Shastri is there was one Srinivas Iyengar in Rangarao Road.
Okay.
And I had gone with someone else. I didn't go for anything. And then he told that I will get gold medal. And I don't know, out of the blue, how did he, neither did I tell my birth date, nor did I say anything. I didn't even ask anything. Yeah. And how did he say that? And then when I finished my MD in general medicine, I stood first to Bangalore University. I got the gold medal. And
nice.
Not that. After that, I got another 36 gold medals. So I was wondering how the hell, heaven, I must say, not the hell, how did he predict that I would get the gold medal? And another person is Venkatramanachar. I had gone another lady who had a real problem with her son. And a lady doctor just accompanied her, and he asked my birth date, and he told I have higher studies. I had already done MD. He said, I'm not telling your past, I'm telling the future.
Right.
And he was right. I did my DM cardiology, I did my pediatric cardiology, And then he said, you'll become world famous. And I did become. So how did they ever predict like this? And I'm not a person who will go to the astrologer, but it happened that they predicted. And so I think that there is a very real, real strong science. And people going to the rogues and getting fooled and then getting into the problem of becoming mentally sick people, depending on, you know, and they are, like extracting on the weak mind, like moon, and then taking, getting the money out of them. I think we have to come out of the whole eclipse that is there on our astrology or what you say, this Shastra. And then the whole world has to open, and we have to, people like you should become world guru in the what you call this Shastra, you know. So any more questions are there in the chat box? Can see? Girish, any questions in the chat box? Okay, there is one question. How did Rishi so accurately find the celestial objects without telescope or elders told Divya Drishti? Now, this is mathematical way or how? And that's a very wonderful question.
Yeah, true. It is a wonderful question. And, you know, it is very interesting that they didn't have the modern gadgets. But just because they didn't have modern gadgets does not mean that they didn't have their own means or they didn't have their own gadgets. You know, we also should understand that they had gadgets, but probably over time we don't have it. And of course, I think the spiritual aspect of it plays a huge role. The pranayama, the meditation also brings in this huge concept of how they were able to identify these celestial objects. It, you know, I think this, you know, it reminds me of Aham Brahmasmi. You know, that is the effect or the power that every person has in himself. When you actually get into the spiritual world, you are able to expand your dimensions and are able to go further and, you know, get connected to the celestial world.
One more thing, you know, I don't know if I'm wrong, you please correct me. I heard that rishis used to get up early in the morning, that is the Brahmi Murta. And whenever they were doing tapas or they were in trance, they used to be one with the Paramatma. So Paramatma and Atma used to be same. And from Shiva himself, they were getting all the knowledge. And that's how it percolated. And then they taught to their students. And I have also seen when I get up in the morning, we were made to get up by our grandparents at 4 o'clock. And probably that's the reason we were studying so well. And I feel that I get brilliant ideas early in the morning, somewhere between 4 or 5 or 6 o'clock. And, you know, the whole day when you're busy with your work, you don't get that sort of brilliant ideas. I think probably they were one with the Supreme Being. And they were not ordinary living beings, like how B.V. Raman was a superhuman being, I could say that. I was wondering, how can one person do so much of a person? That must be the thing. There's one more question from Tarun Prasad. Ma'am, please give technical details to Sarpa Dosha. What is the reason behind its presence in a horoscope? What kind of deeds causes this Sarpa Dosha?
All right. First of all, Sarpa Dosha, when you call it, let me give one of the types of Sarpa Dosha, for instance. So we see that one of the types of Sarpa Dosha is the Kala Sarpa Dosha, where in the natal horoscope, if the Rahu's path, you know, the Rahu's path is the anti-clockwise movement. So when the Rahu's path and Rahu Ketu's path, if there are any planets, it's called Purna Kala Sarpa Dosha. So please identify that first and don't go by the logic of, you know, a lot of people get it wrong. And even if there is more than one graha that is left out of this path, then it is not Kala Sarpa Dosha. So you need to first identify that. All right, that was the first question. The second one is, what probably could have caused it? Now, the reason probably could have caused it, you know, there are, we believe, first of all, Hinduism is all about giving respect, and each living being is considered God. Now, there are, in Jyotish Shastram, we have noted that you could get this kind of a Sarpa Dosha if in the previous, the karma or the previous Janma or your ancestors have ended up either incidentally or accidentally killing a Sarpa, then it could actually pass on to the next or the next to next generations. So you also need to understand that that could be one of the reasons. And it also could be, like we say, that soul is never ending, right? Only the mortal body ends. So even we could be carrying the past karmas that we are carrying from our previous souls. So they could be all these various reasons. And, that's why it's a beauty of Hinduism that you need to love and respect all living beings. It's not just, yourself.
Yeah, I fully agree with you, Archana, because Paramatma's Amsha is there in every living being as Atma. Right. And Prarabdha continues despite of changing the body or whether you are a bird or animal or a human being. And there is an interesting story from Mahabharata. Since mm-hmm. you talked about the snake and the Prarabdha and the past Janma, I would like to tell that story. When Bhishma Pitamaha, he was on Sarashaya, and he was a very dharmishta, always on the side of Dharma. How did he get that torture of lying on the arrows, the thing? And then Krishna tells him that so many Janmas back, when he was a prince, he was going on a chariot and he saw a Sarpa in front of his chariot. And he thinks that the Sarpa may be caught under his chariot wheel. So he takes his arrow, lifts it and then throws it on the side without realizing where it is falling. Then unfortunately it fell on the plant on the side of the road. And that's how he got the, you want the curse or the karma. And then only good deed gets the karma, gets a good thing, and the bad one gets a bad. So that's how he had to suffer. See, it may appear like, a cock and bull story, but whatever it is, it teaches a moral story that never do any harm to anyone knowingly or unknowingly. So that is the essence of our Hindu Dharma.
True.
Any other question? Well, if there are no other questions, I would like to really thank that I have been into so many programs, but never have I enjoyed so much listening to you. And you could be a master teacher because I have been a professor for so long. And I think you can take up the teaching profession as well because you are so lucid and clear in your thought. And I would like to thank Archana Murthy and also pay respects to her father, who has inculcated such wonderful lessons in his daughter. And I also owe a great lot to my father also. That's how I relate. And thank you very much for coming here and giving the endowment lecture. Thank you very much. And a big clap for you, Archana.
Thanks a lot for your encouragement. Really, we really require such words so that, we can continue in this process. Yes.
Archana, we are expecting too much from you.
Future.
In so many fields.
Thank you.
And I would like to thank Dr. Gayatri. And you are so knowledgeable, so humble, down to earth, you are an embodiment almost like a Saraswati. And it was wonderful having you to preside for the function. And we are very, very grateful to you. On behalf of Indian Institute of World Culture, I thank both of you. You are so knowledgeable and so good. And not the people who are fooling the, innocent people. Very, very grateful to you. But last but not the least, I would like to really, really pray with my whole heart and our Nasma Smarane Madbekandre B.V. Raman. And I am sure, he has single-handedly taken the whole our Jyotish Shastra to the international level. It is amazing. And his his own son Niranjan Babu, as well as the grandson Ramanand, they are continuing that. So we are so grateful. May your tribe increase and many more lectures like this, and let the younger generation get inspiration and come into this picture. And last but not the least, I would like to thank our own Indian Institute of World Culture, the President Prasad and the Secretary, Ventesh, and all the staff, and more than that, all the youngsters and even the old people who have joined and who are going to see this in the YouTube in the future. I wish all of them the best. And here I would like to end with the Upanishad saying, which says, as is our desire, so is our will. As is our will, so is our deed. As is our deed, so is our destiny. So namma sankalpa hegirutto hage namma karmagalu, namma karma hegirutto hage namma mundina bhavishya. Hagagi bhavishya kelakke innobra hatra avaru kai munde chaachid hage portrikon avaru kai chaachad beda. Let the people believe in themselves, the self confidence, and go ahead. And whatever has to happen, the God will definitely give you for the hard work that you put in. And with these words, I would like to thank each one of you. And I would like to thank especially Niranjan Babu for having chosen three women to host the whole program. And we are very, very grateful to the whole Raman family and the clan. Wish you all Shubharatri. ಭಗವಂತ ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಆಯುಷ್ಯ ಸಂಪತ್ತು ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿ ನೆಮ್ಮದಿ ಯಶಸ್ಸು ತೇಜಸ್ಸು ವರ್ಚಸ್ಸನ್ನು ಕೊಟ್ಟು ನಮ್ಮ ಅರ್ಚನಾ ಮೂರ್ತಿ ಅಂತವರು ಇನ್ನೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚೆಚ್ಚು ಬರಲಿ ಅಂತ ಹಾಕುತ್ತಾ ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಶುಭರಾತ್ರಿ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಮ್ಯಾಮ್. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.